And we're now joined in the studio by the flag officer in command of the Philippine Navy, Vice Admiral Toribio Adasi Jr. Vice Admiral, good morning
to
you. Thank you for being on Head Start.
Good morning.
I know this is your first live interview, so I wanted to welcome you.
Thank you.
So this afternoon concludes actually the two-day naval exercise.
Yes.
That's correct. Just how significant is this?
Well, it's an important event because this is the second iteration of the exercise, and it puts together the ASEAN navies, the warships of the ASEAN navies, to test our interoperability, our doctrines, our way of communicating, and see if they align. We also would like to test the guidelines for maritime interaction, a protocol which the Navy chiefs, the ASEAN Navy chiefs, has just ratified earlier, just before the exercise.
And just how many? I know that at, with 10 ASEAN countries, 7, you said, have actually brought ships.
Yes, madam. 7 ASEAN countries sent their ships. And 3 countries sent observers to this event.
This is the second of its kind. What makes this significant, especially today, that there are issues in the West Philippine Sea and also with other countries in the South China Sea?
Yes, it's a show of unity. You know, we have different interests, competing interests, but at the end of the day, there are mutual interests that we can share, particularly furthering peace and order in this in our regional environment, particularly in the regional and in the maritime waters.
It's a show of unity, but until today, President Marcos Jr. has even asked what is causing the delay with a code of conduct when it comes to the South China Sea. How important is it to have a code of conduct?
Yeah, we support the government's position that a code of conduct should be ratified among ASEAN and China at a higher level, more than the mere declaration of the conduct of parties in the South China Sea passed in 2002. And we support the government's position on this.
But give me a practical scenario in the waters, for example. With the absence of a code of conduct, how does this affect movement with the Philippine Navy, the Coast Guard, even our own fishermen? It, you know, what needs to be ironed out in a code of conduct?
There are international regulations which guide the actions of vessels at sea. For example, the 1972 Coal Regs, collision regulations, which intends to promote safety at sea and prevent collision. There are rules that vessels, warships, and commercial vessels should follow so as to avoid endangering other vessels. Like, for example, ships that meet each other at sea should show their intention early. They should display their correct lights and flag signals. Those are protocols that are internationally accepted and practiced nowadays.
And we need a code of conduct for this?
Not necessarily, but an agreement that we abide by it. An agreement that we abide by it.
Okay. So, Vice Admiral, the Philippine Coast Guard just reported that they received a radio call challenge from the Chinese Navy while they were sailing near Pag-asa Island. Where does this put the code of conduct and also the Philippine Navy, considering that it's the Coast Guard that received a call from the Chinese Navy?
Yes, our Navy is there, continuously patrolling our seas in the west, western part of the Philippines. I would just like to add that, you know, nowadays, the maritime environment has become complex. Nations have resorted to the use of white ships, I'm referring to Coast Guard ships, to prosecute their territorial claims. And that blurs the distinction between the Navy and the Coast Guard.
Yeah, because the Navy are what you call the gray ships.
Gray ships, yes.
Yeah, the Coast Guard are the white ships, okay.
And we also respond white to white, avoiding a gray to white meeting because it connotes a different thing. It may be escalatory or it may be misconstrued as an aggressive action. And that is why we often see we often see incidents where Coast Guard vessels are involved.
But the Chinese don't seem to care. I mean, considering that you have a Chinese, the Chinese Navy issuing a radio challenge to the Coast Guard, what is the protocol after such an action? Should the Philippine Navy respond back?
We have a set of protocols adapted. We have a national task force that synchronizes all the agencies of the Philippine government in addressing issues in the West Philippine Sea. And this is the National Task Force on the West Philippine Sea.
No, but I'm curious, in a situation like this, it's breaking, it's current, it just happened. What is the action of the Philippine Navy, or is there?
Experience will tell us that the Chinese vessels challenge us, and we also challenge them. We
have should it be the Coast Guard who respond?
It's normal that they also challenge Coast Guard vessels in the same way that they can challenge any commercial vessel in the area. And we also do the same. We also do the same.
Okay. So what is the response of the Philippine Navy with this report?
There is a set challenge by the Coast Guard and by our Navy. I'm not privy to the exact wordings of the challenge, but we reply to them. We reply to them.
But I'm curious, forgive me for pressing on this, because the Philippine Coast Guard said they were bringing aid to the residents, and a radio challenge was issued. So instinctively or in protocol, what should happen in the next few hours?
I assume there would be exchange of communication, exchange of challenges, but after that they break off from the area.
But should the Chinese Navy be issuing a radio challenge to our Coast Guard? Or are they crossing boundaries?
I believe the scenario happened in the Pag-asa, in the vicinity of Pag-asa, and it's obvious who is crossing the boundary.
So China should not have issued a radio challenge.
That's my opinion.
Okay. All right. Now, just recently, last April, the National Task Force on the West Philippine Sea said there were more than 100 Chinese vessels spotted in our exclusive economic zone. As the Vice Admiral of the Navy, it seems that the country has lived with the presence of Chinese vessels in our territory. What should be done?
We have to also come up with approaches to counter this gray zone tactics. You know, they have resorted to gray zone operations, actions which are not considered as aggression below the threshold of war, but in pursuit of their intent. And I believe we are in the midst of discussion of how to deal with them.
Can you be more specific when you say we're in the midst of discussion on how to deal with
our national task force on the West Philippine Sea is addressing that other agencies of our government.
But of course there's the diplomatic front, there's the DFA also issuing note verbals, but in terms of the Philippine Navy, in terms of strategy, what should change given the fact that China has not held off?
On our end, we hope our operational commands continue to assert our presence in the area. We should continue to patrol the seas in the West Philippine Sea.
So let's talk about that right now. We often hear about the Philippine Coast Guard patrolling the West Philippine Sea. What is the Navy's role right now? In a time of peace, as you said, their actions are below the threshold. Right? So what is the Philippine Navy, what's the mandate right now?
We still are mandated by our constitution, our laws, to protect the sovereignty of our state and the security, integrity of national territory. And through these patrols, naval patrols that we do, we ensure that we perform our mandate.
Yeah. So do we have Navy ships right now that are out in the West Philippine Sea?
the Unified Command, the Western Command, is in charge of the patrol operations. But I believe there are at present. We are doing regular patrols, reprovisioning operations, and maritime operations in that area of our country.
Okay. Now, there's been talk about having joint patrols with the United States. How has that progressed?
It came out in the papers, and I've heard discussions about that, but we have yet to receive official directives on that. We will abide by what the government says.
Well, the last administration was more cautious of actually conducting joint patrols with the United States, and no less than actually, I believe I interviewed Secretary Galvez then, and he said it would be provocative, so to speak, with China. But now times have changed. It seems that we are moving toward joint patrols. Do you believe that we should have joint patrols with the U.S.?
We will abide by the Navy is ready to undertake joint patrols if that is directed by our leadership, and the Navy is ready to do that.
Okay. Have we recently had joint patrols with other, with I mean, even if the U.S. is our only treaty ally, we do have other countries that we could have had joint patrols with for interoperability as well?
Basically, those are exercises as differed from actual patrols. We do a lot of exercises with allies and like-minded states. Like, for example, the last edition of our Balikatan, we had...
which was the largest.
Maritime exercises with the United States.
So we've never had joint patrols, not even with other countries like Australia, for example.
We had joint patrols, but like, for example, the TCA or the Trilateral Cooperative Agreement that we have with Malaysia and Indonesia, we do joint patrols in that area of Sulu Seas, Celebes Sea, and it has been very successful.
Okay. How important and significant is it now to do joint patrols considering China's actions?
It can show unity among like-minded states, but of course these are decisions to be taken up by our leadership.
What about the role of ASEAN here? I know that the Philippine Navy has proposed amendments in the conduct of ASEAN multilateral naval exercises. These are improvements. Can you enumerate some of these amendments?
There were proposals that instead of doing exercises at sea, we can also have exercises on land among staffs to test also the readiness of our support systems, our planning staff to test their interoperability and their competence to work together in planning for military operations, for naval operations.
Vice Admiral, how would you advance the Navy? I mean, clearly in the last few years, we've seen a lot, especially when the budget is being made. We've seen a lot of lobby for the armed forces of the Philippines, and it's often about peace and order against communist rebels, so to speak. In the last administration, there was a lot of that. But let's face it, the challenge is really out in the West Philippine Sea. It's really guarding our territorial waters, giving confidence to our naval men, our Coast Guard. How should we advance the Navy?
Yes, Karen, it's very important to advance our Navy. Number one, we are a maritime country of more than 7,000 islands. And we have also to protect our blue economy. And for the past several years, we have seen an improvement of our Navy from the old revolutionary Navy in 1898 to what it is today. We have a vision to become a modern and multi-capable naval force by 2028.
Okay.
And of course, a modern Navy can best protect our sovereignty, can better secure the integrity of our national territory.
Okay, and how are we gonna do that? Let's talk about first the budget. I know that recently, the Philippine Navy christened two new Israel-made patrol gunships. So where are the gunships now?
The gunships are undergoing further tests, and soon they will be deployed in the operational areas. The Navy is in the midst of modernization, and we hope to acquire more platforms. And along with it, of course, are other modernization thrusts like organizational development, training for these new assets, and revision of doctrines to see how we can better operate with this modern equipment.
Yeah. Now, clearly, we can't compete with a superpower, but we can strengthen the Philippine Navy.
Yes, yes.
That's fair. Right? Because there are other, our neighbors are also small, but they're equipping the Philippine, their Navy too.
Yes.
So other than the two patrol gunships, what is the target, for example, of the Philippine Navy?
Our modernization program laid out Horizons 1, 2, and 3, which enables us to acquire assets and platforms and systems to modernize our Navy.
Yeah.
And the end state is to be able to establish a credible defense posture for our Navy. Along with it is the acquisition of different capabilities. Surface,
and how many?
Subsurface,
air. I don't mean to interrupt, sir. I mean, how many ships are we talking about? Is that part of the target?
Yes, we have a desired force mix where we identified how many frigates, how many corvettes, how many OPVs, how many gunboats, even how many submarines, aircraft do we need.
And will this be seen under the leadership of President Marcos Jr.? In other words, can this be covered in the 6 years?
Of course, it will extend beyond the 6 years, but we are happy to note that even in previous administrations, the modernization has started, and under the present leadership, full support has been coming in, and we are happy to note that our projects for the modernization program shall continue.
Are you allowed to say how many ships we have on air?
We have, all in all, our floating assets are less than 100.
Okay.
Less than 100.
And what is the target of the Philippine Navy?
We have a mixture of, say, for example, our offshore patrol vessels, we desire to have 18. And, for example, our multipurpose or fast attack craft missile, we should have 24 or 25. These are numbers we desire to get in the future.
I wanted to ask you, the Philippine Coast Guard just recently placed 5 buoys to mark the Philippine territory in the West Philippine Sea. So we're putting buoys, so to speak. And one of the areas marked with the buoys is the Julian Felipe Reef. As the Vice Admiral of the Philippine Navy, how can we protect the West Philippine Sea without actually going into war, but just to strengthen presence so you don't have Chinese ships harassing our fishermen, you don't have the Chinese Navy issuing these radio calls? What can the Philippine Navy do? Is it time to change the strategy?
On our end, on the Navy's end, through our operational commands, we should continue to establish our presence in the West Philippine Sea and in the islands that we occupy.
And when you say establish our presence, what do you mean? Do you mean to have a Navy ship stationed at certain spots of the West Philippine Sea for a few weeks, a few months? Speak in layman's terms.
That can be part of the tactics or the techniques that we can adapt. In the islands, we have troops there. The ships can patrol the area on a rotational basis.
Yeah. Are we doing that now?
We are doing that.
Should we do more?
Ang maganda kasing nangyari ngayon, for example, in that part of our country, mas marami ng barko ang na-assign doon ngayon. So they have more options to utilize. So they can increase the number of the
who
patrols.
Who is they?
I mean, the operational command, which is the Western Command.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But when you say the Western Command, it means more ships with the Philippine Coast Guard?
No, there are more Philippine Navy ships now.
Mm-mm.
Under the operational control of Western Command.
So how would you describe the presence of our Navy ships in the West Philippine Sea? Just right? Is it lacking? Should there be more? I mean, describe.
At present, I think this is just right.
Oh.
Yes, just right.
Uh-oh. Okay, what makes you say that?
Mas marami ng barko ngayon na nandun eh. So they can patrol more frequently.
Okay, all right. Now, advancing the Navy is, of course, this administration's priority, you had said. And in terms of the budget, have you seen a dramatic shift?
We should give focus on external defense operations because,
okay,
as you've mentioned a while ago, the challenge is really on our territorial waters.
Yes. Okay. Now, we are adding more ships, but then do we have the people?
Yes. Alongside the acquisition of platforms, the ships, andun din yung component ng recruitment, training, creation of doctrines, force restructuring, to make the organization adapt to a modern Navy.
But how many personnel does the Philippine Navy have today, and what is the target per year?
At present, we have a total of 25,000 Navy personnel, both the sailors and the Marines.
Mm-hmm.
And we do recruitment on a yearly basis, basing also on the desired, for example, with bringing in new platforms, new vessels, then we have to input that in our computation as to the number of people we are going to recruit for the next few years.
Uh-oh. And describe the takers. Is it successful, the recruitment process of the Navy?
Yes.
Because with the DOH, for example, with nurses, the plantilla is there, but it's been quite a challenge, they say.
Sa amin, we do not have problem with the applicants to join the Navy.
Uh-oh.
Maraming applicants.
Maraming applicants.
Of course, but we target also the desired competencies and technical skills.
Mm-hmm.
Like, for example, preferences for magagaling sa computers, engineering,
mm-hmm,
things
mm-hmm,
like those.
Mm-hmm. So, this coming May, the Navy will be celebrating its
125th
anniversary, 125 years of the Philippine Navy. What are you seeing? What's the theme, the priority of this year's celebration?
Well, our theme is basically focused on our sailors and Marines as the guardians of our sovereignty and sovereign rights and our territories, and would like to emphasize on the modernization of our organization, not only on the platforms, but also on how we are on the organization, on our human resources, mm-hmm, our doctrines, mm-hmm, and other support components of our program.
All right. Anything you want to advise, Admiral, before we go?
Ang sa akin lang is let us support our Navy. The Navy can best secure our sovereignty as a nation and our territorial integrity if we have a modern and multi-capable Navy.
All right. On that note,
thank
Vice Admiral Adasi, thank you so much for joining me today.